As a Catholic Church, communion is not about communion only with each other. It's first communion with God. And therefore, I think what we need to do is come to a basic understanding that receiving communion is really the great gift. Distributing communion is a privilege, but also a responsibility that requires us not to be judges at the time, but faithful administrators of the sacrament. Welcome to the Father Leo Show, where I'm dishing out faith, culture, and commentary. Thank you for watching this episode as I kind of delve into what it means to be trans as a Catholic. And when I say trans, I'm talking about transformed and, in a way, transubstantiated. Let's talk a little bit about the Eucharist. But before we jump into it, I want to say thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing. And if you haven't done so yet, please share this video and our show with family and friends. Encourage them to click subscribe as well as to like the videos, to make your comments, because I certainly want to be able to have conversations with you. And also, if you are able, please, only $5 a month on our Patreon community gives you access to so many of our other fantastic opportunities, talks, and just special perks and other content, which I know will certainly feed you body, mind, and soul. So let's get into it with a little discussion on faith and the Eucharist. Being a priest who is different from, say, your normal parish priest, the work that they do is superb and much needed in the church. I always considered the diocesan priesthood or anyone who works in parish life as kind of like the skeletal system of the Catholic Church, where they are truly the structure where people can come and receive the sacraments, which is the key to our salvation. Then you have missionary priests like me who have to go out and try to get people excited to come to the church. And when they're there, to also prepare them and to get them excited. We just are considered itinerant preachers or evangelists in a way. But still, even if I'm on the road quite a bit, I still celebrate Mass every day. And when I'm in a different community, I usually take all of the Masses. So in a sense, I do more weekend Masses than some priests do, and they're part of a parish. But that's just my job, and I'm happy to do it. But the greatest joy that I have is being able to receive communion. My whole faith and food movement is not just about making great steaks or spaghetti or egg rolls. No, it's really about connecting the Eucharistic meal to our family meals at home so that we can see what Jesus is trying to do is invite you to be a part of his family. And how does he get us to become a part of his family? Well, he does what really ticked off the religious leaders at the time. He ate with people. His miracles around food, from his first, the wedding feast of Cana, the second, where he basically turned, you know, a few fish sandwiches into a feast for 5,000 men, not counting women and children, with guess what? Leftovers. And we know how Filipinos love collecting leftovers and bringing it to their own homes. And that's why I always think that Jesus was slightly Filipino, because when he fed his disciples breakfast on the shore of Galilee, after the resurrection, he served them fish. You know, so when we talk about the Eucharist, we cannot talk about it simply only as food. All of the food references in the scriptures were pointing to something else, the bread of life, the cup of eternal salvation, which he talks about at the Last Supper. And while the word transubstantiation does not show up in the Bible, it shows up in logic, because at the time that Jesus said, "This is my body, this is my blood," and then repeating it in all of the John Gospel of John chapter 6 accounts, talking about eat my flesh, drink my blood, and the word eat that he was using was chew. And when he talked about flesh, he really talked about bloody flesh, and that's why many people left him. They said, I can't take this kind of teaching. And then he turns to the disciples, says, you know, do you also want to leave? And Peter responds, well, who else shall we go to? You have the words of eternal life. And if Jesus's word says, this is my body, this is my blood, then guess what? A miracle has occurred. And that miracle is called a transubstantiation, not a transformation. The flesh and blood does not turn into, excuse me, the bread and wine does not turn into flesh and blood, but the substance of the bread and wine, the very being, the very essence of it, does change. You know, and I have to think that the whole trans debate is really because they don't know who they are on the inside. So they want to change their accidents. They want to change their physicality. And as such, they think they're going to change the very core of who they are. Nope, not at all. Because we, doctors, pharmacists who are prescribing these hormone-blocking medications, they don't have that power. God can change our substance from sinner to saint in the sacrament of confession. God can change our substance. He can truly turn me into a trans person, so to speak, when my substance is changed. My outside doesn't look any different. Like when I became a priest, my outside looked exactly the same, but my substance changed because God has that power to do so. And that's why, you know, we focus on some of these Eucharistic miracles that Blessed Carlo Acutis cataloged in his website that he put together. I want to show you a video of one that I just saw that happened in 2023. It is kind of an interesting thing because it's I don't know what to make of it. Anyway, let's take a look. I'd love to hear what you think. Okay. Here we go. So it's looking like a host is suspended and just kind of turning around, almost as if it was like a magnetic field of some sort. I actually don't know what part of the Mass this is, but as you kind of watch, you're going to see how this is after the consecration of the host. And now I saw him just pick up the chalice. He's now what they call the doxology through him with him in him. He's got the paten in his hand where he has the host that he will himself consume. The deacon is holding the chalice. But yet, if you pan down, this host is still just kind of flickering around. Of course, the music is eerie, so it definitely has some kind of mystical property to it. I mean, it would be fantastic to see what's happening here. I mean, this is dated 2/11/23, so it wasn't too far off. But we know that there have been other Eucharistic miracles as well. Interesting. I certainly love to hear what you think about that. I mean, have you ever experienced a Eucharistic miracle? Who knows? But I know that there have been cases where some visionaries or some locutionists, one received the host on her tongue and it turned into flesh. We know that the Eucharistic miracles of Orvieto, of Bolzano, of Lanciano, where the Eucharist, the species, the bread turned into flesh, the wine turned into blood. These things are very real. Unfortunately, I think we've all been a little too casual with communion. And as a Eucharistic revival preacher, it's my job to not only get people excited about church and receiving communion, but to teach them about how to receive communion. So first of all, I want to show you this charming video. I can only imagine what it's like for the priest of this parish. Check this out. This is kind of funny, cute, but also kind of a stark reminder of what we need to do to prepare people for receiving First Communion. Especially First Communion. Check this out.
It is time for the highs and lows of the week. Our first low goes to the feeling when a powerful thirst strikes, just as you're stepping up to receive your First Communion. A young girl from South Dakota named Brinley became an internet star this week after her mother, Stephanie, recorded her sweet daughter power chugging the Blessed Sacrament. looking absolutely angelic in a pretty white gown and veil. Brindley politely approaches the priest, who offers her first the body of Christ and then the blood.
The blood of Christ.
That was quite the reception of the Holy Eucharist. That surprising she could actually walk straight after that. Well, you know, as a parish priest, and I've had many years in parish, and I'm in parishes all the time, stuff like this happens all the time. Now, I know a lot of traditional people will get very angry and be like, how dare she? And, you know, probably like make the parents feel bad and make fun of the priest somehow because he did a bad job. You know, what can you do in a sense? Well, obviously you can do a lot more in terms of preparation for it. I will have to say that First Communions have become a little bit more of an opportunity for people to get good pictures. And I don't know where people's hearts are. I really don't. But I do know that it can be done in a more sacred way so that the preeminence of the dignity and the most holy presence of Christ in the Eucharist isn't diminished by the cuteness of the children and even by this very sweet mistake of consuming more of the precious blood. First of all, when I was a kid growing up receiving communion, we didn't even receive the precious blood because we were taught that the body and the blood were contained in the one species. You see one, you see both. The flesh and the blood are united, especially because of that fraction rite that the priest does in breaking a piece of the host and putting it in the chalice. So pay attention. The next time you're at Mass and you see the Lamb of God, that's called the fraction rite. You'll see the priest take a small piece of the consecrated host and place it into the chalice, which shows the union between blood and body. It's almost as if reminding us that when Jesus gives us flesh and blood, it's not coagulated. It's not, the blood is still very present in the flesh. It isn't separated. You know, like you can tell that someone is dead, they're cadavers, because the blood is, in a sense, dried up and separate themselves in a way from the flesh itself. And that's why it's no longer bloody if you break into a petrified cadaver, so to speak. But in this case, it's very easy for cuteness to kind of diminish the sacred presence of Christ in the Eucharist. Now, again, I am not faulting anyone here because stuff like this happens all the time. I mean, I've heard stories of how, you know, one child received the precious blood and just didn't like the taste and kind of spit up and made him gag. And good Lord, it's not the kid's fault, but, you know, can we do something to make communion a little bit more sacred? I want to contrast this to another video that I saw of kids receiving their first Holy Communion. Well, we clearly have people who are celebrating, Catholics who are celebrating the Tridentine Rite, which Pope Francis has kind of reduced the opportunity for celebrating what is known as the Latin Mass, which is a really unfortunate name because I can celebrate the Novus Ordo in Latin. But I just want to compare and contrast. Again, I'm not saying that one is better than the other, but one is certainly more solemn than the other. You saw these children receiving communion. They had candles in their hand. They genuflected to a priest. There were two attendants. I mean, it was clearly a more traditional approach. He was wearing a fiddle back, which is a type of vestment chasuble. And then, of course, they were actually, the assistants were holding a paten, which is a plate with a handle on it, and keeping it under the chin. They clearly received communion on their tongue. They didn't receive the precious blood. So there was no opportunity for, you know, again, innocent, but kind of cute opportunity, which again can sometimes diminish the power of the sacramental moment. In the same way, you know, when I baptize children, it's a powerful sacred moment. I invite people to please be seated. Don't get up to take pictures. Pray with us at this time. We'll have many opportunities after the baptism to do the memorabilia, the pictures, and all of that. And then I designate one person to videotape and then one person to take pictures, so you don't have swarms of people kind of crowding in and making the baptism about the pictures rather than the baptism. The communion about cuteness rather than receiving communion, which is the same in grace. And I do think that there is a need to return to a more sacred approach when receiving communion. But I can tell you that I get a little frustrated whenever I see priests making a big deal about people receiving communion while they're kneeling, because technically no one should be denied communion if they receive it on their knees. If there is an altar rail and people use the altar rail, of course they're going to kneel if they can. But I also have seen people not able to kneel, and so they will stand at the altar rail. And, you know, whether they receive it on their tongue or the hand, it doesn't necessarily matter to me. I care more about the disposition of their soul. Now, granted, people can be way more casual with the hand.
Grace Before Meals was the first book that I'd ever written, and I had no idea it would turn into a bestseller. And with so many different chapters, you can celebrate feast days, because as a Catholic faith, we have more feast days than fast days. So family-friendly meals with a little essay, accompanying prayers, and questions to engage your family in meaningful dinner conversations, this book will help you to continue feasting with your family all year long.
If you're watching this, can I just please give you the logistics on how to receive communion, either in hand or on your tongue? And let's presume that we're standing. And you're going to say, you know, but you are you standing, Father Leo? Of course I'm standing. I'm just short. But let's get right to it, okay? Let me just do a quick tutorial. You approach the line. Your hands can be folded like this. You know, there is a tradition in America where if you cross your arms like this, you can come up to receive a blessing. That doesn't show up anywhere, but I'm not going to argue with people. The challenging part is that there are some countries that approach like this so that they know that they're going to receive on their tongue. So hello, confusion alert. We need to make sure that people are receiving communion in a proper way. So generally, hands folded, and you do a solemn bow before receiving, and then you place your hand out. And notice where my hand is. It is up here. It is up. It's not dropped down here where I have to drop Jesus on a parachute. No, please keep your hands elevated. Don't grab. Don't grab. All right, just simply keep your hands up. And after you receive communion, say amen, and then receive, and then you walk away. Please don't walk away, because I am going to stop you, because there have been some people who've literally walked away and kept it, and they use it, unfortunately, for nefarious, demonic, satanic, cultural, cult reasons. Or, you know, the story we were told in the seminary is that a priest was looking at the pictures of First Holy Communion, and lo and behold, the host was in the photo album. Come on, people. This is terrible. And so just bow your heads, say amen, hands out, receive it on your tongue and move, or bow down, amen, open your mouth, and put out your tongue. Don't go like this, because there's no way that that host is going to fit on your tongue, and then it just can fall. That's why that patent is in place to catch the species, the sacred species, if anything like that happens. And I know that nobody wants anything like that to happen. I know that. But you avoid these little mishaps by opening up your mouth. I know that I'm not going to throw anybody under the bus, but there's particular cultures that don't open their mouth. They kind of go like this. And they kind of like want to catch it on their, between their lips. And then that basically means I've got to be like the operation game and just insert it ever so appropriately. And then sometimes people bite my finger. Gosh, I know that this is, I know that this might sound like I'm making a mockery of communion. I'm not. I'm trying to make sure that people are receiving it in a sacred way. Because this is the highest point of our week on Sunday Mass. This is the highest point of our day. Honestly, it's the highest point of our life, receiving communion in a sacred way. So please, bow, amen, hands up, receive communion, gently move to the side, or bow, amen, and put out your tongue so that I can place the host on your tongue. Don't lick my finger, don't bite my finger. This is kind of crazy, I know, but I don't think we've taught people well these days. And I get more frustrated when there are priests who might be opposed to denying, say, pro-abortion public figures, politicians, Hollywood celebrities who claim to be Catholic but want to, you know, kill unborn babies. They might say, oh, they should be able to receive communion, but at the same time, they're going to deny someone communion because they're going to receive it on their knees. Check this out. This is frustrating. We're at a Vatican Mass. Someone's making his way up to the side. Wants to receive communion. The priest denies him. He's trying to receive it, and he pulls away. Come on. Come on. That's just... I don't know who that priest is, but that priest should be reprimanded. I mean, when I was giving communion out as a priest in the Vatican, and I lived there for 6 years, we were just told to make sure that people receive communion. We tried to have them avoid it on their hand, because oftentimes, especially in cold weather, they had gloves and, you know, they kind of reach out for people. We wanted to make sure that they actually received and communicated the Eucharist and not just walked away from it, because many people wanted to keep the Eucharist as a souvenir from the Vatican. But in this case, the fact that the priest kind of was like pulled it away, I don't know who that priest is, but I would like to maybe just have a conversation with him and say, what were you thinking? I mean, that was caught on like the Vatican TV, and it was embarrassing because this is a man, a communicant, who came with absolute humility. He didn't look wealthy. He was sitting in the stands like everybody else. He wasn't in the prima fila, the first row, so to speak. And he just went down to receive communion, and he gets denied? What's that about? But even worse, check this out. This is a little even more kind of frustrating. What? Wait, what? Oh, wow. Nope. Nope, 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 nope. The girl was obviously more traditional. She had an altar veil on, and she's denied communion. But then she chooses not to receive communion? That might be her pride. She might need just to simply receive communion on her tongue. Because whether you receive it on your knees or on your tongue doesn't take away the sacred nature of the body of Christ. And so while the priest was, I don't know, a little obtuse, so is she. And then you see a man, again, from South America, it looked like, and he's on his knees, and the priest just serves the person behind him, reaches over him. What are we doing? As a Catholic Church, communion is not about communion only with each other. It's first communion with God. And therefore, I think what we need to do is come to a basic understanding that receiving communion is really the great gift. Distributing communion is a privilege, but also a responsibility that requires us not to be judges at the time, but faithful administrators of the sacrament. This has nothing to do with politics, because everyone always seems to think that I make political comment. Look, if a pro-abortionist comes to my communion line and people are videotaping that, well, then that might be a spectacle, and I would have known that beforehand and would have called their people to make sure that they understand it's better for them to either be seated or come to me for confession beforehand so that I can, in a proper way and in a very spiritually confident way, distribute communion to that person. So, I mean, high-profile political leaders, let's put this aside. These are simple people trying to receive communion. That's all it is. To deny them because they receive it on their knees is abhorrent to me. But to not be able to receive communion because you can only receive it on your knees is just as obtuse. It's just as closed-minded. There's a lot of that in the church these days, and we've got to get rid of it. So, listen, as bad as all this is, I kind of want to at least end on somewhat a note that might be a little bit more light, maybe even silly, but I'm sorry I had to do it. I found this video and it just made me laugh. Because while we as Catholics are struggling to learn how to receive communion well and how to teach it well, at least we're not going to church where we get this.
Dropping the loaf for Jesus. Keep the Lord in mind.
Wow.
When you dirty wine, drop it for Jesus. In the club, shake it to the floor and show it love. I'm on the grind, cause for my sins he died.
Wow.
Died, cause I know I'll be at the pearly gates for show. I'll be in the number when the trumpet starts to blow.
Wow.
But tonight I gotta drop it low.
Whoa. Dropping it low for Jesus. You can't. I don't even know what to say about that, but I found it and I just thought that it was funny and I'm not being disrespectful, but I hope we don't get to the point where our church has songs like this. Some of them are getting close to it, just saying, but thank God we are not there. Not making fun of that. Look, if that is the way that they want to worship, more power to them. I don't know how that actually glorifies God. It seems to be more about us and the background dancers, but I think we've got to just make sure that we do one thing when we receive communion. Remember, it's not about you. It's not about the minister of communion distributing communion. It's about the Eucharist, his body, blood, soul, and divinity. Make sure we have a proper disposition to receive communion. Let's make sure we receive communion properly and well, use the proper form, know the local customs, and let's not be so pig-headed and blind and obtuse. If someone comes to you and you're in that kind of like side of the church where you say, I don't want to use the altar rail and I don't want to give communion to people on their knees, please give it to them. And if you're one of those people who can only receive it on the knees and you think that standing is disrespectful, then you're going to need to learn how to kind of grow up in your faith as well. Because then it becomes about you. These are some hard lessons, but you know what? Thank God we're not 100% in charge of the church. We have to trust that Jesus is not only the foundation, he is the church, he is the body of Christ, and guess what? We are what we eat. I hope that this was at least somewhat interesting and enjoyable conversation. Please let me know your thoughts. Do you prefer to receive communion on your tongue or on your hands? Have you ever had any unique communion stories? Let us know in the comments. Make sure you let family and friends know to click subscribe and to share. And also please support us on our Patreon so that we can offer you a whole cache of great content. But more importantly, we can continue to dish out faith, culture, and commentary. God bless you. Stay hungry for God.